Good morning, everyone. My name is Marty Stanton. I was fortunate to be able to chair the Standard Forms Committee for NVAR this past year in 2021. And I'm really excited about having the opportunity to take you through the updates that became effective January 1st. I'm going to take you through the presentation, but before I do, I want you all to know that this is being recorded. So in the future, if you want to review this again, you certainly have the opportunity to do so. We are going to share a link in the chat, which will have essentially, you can go to the educational version of all the forms. If you want to follow using the forms, I have taken snippets in the presentation of the changes, and I've put them throughout the presentation that I have done for you here. So you can do either. Just want you to know that that's available to you. And then questions that come up in the chat, if you can, if you have a question, please put it in the chat. My colleague and friend Maria will be looking at those and responding. And then obviously, if it's something that she feels like I need to address, she will then go ahead and ask me the question and I'll address it. So with that, let's get started. And the first is just an overview. What we're going to be discussing today is the residential sales contract that we've revised, the home inspection and radon testing contingency addendum, the inspection contingency and removal addendum, the exclusive right to sell and exclusive agency listing agreement, the optional listing information sheet, and then the new form that we've provided, the optional buyer offer cover sheet. Just to give you a little bit of an overview, what we did this year, what we were challenged to do is really be thinking forward with our contract and essentially how we want this to be the best contract that's available in the area. The most concise, clear version of the contract, and really create a foundation that's going to allow us to build on as our industry continues to grow, both from a professional standpoint as well as from a technology standpoint. So we really were forward thinking, but as you all know, because you're all in real estate, obviously, the way that you do that is by building a great foundation. And so we spent the vast majority of our time focusing on the residential sales contract and addressing those issues. And then ultimately, when you make changes there, that leads to some other changes. And the rest of the forms, probably that we talk about the revisions, are related to those changes. And then obviously, we always take your input and feedback from other forms that we've had great success. And so the optional listing information sheet, when we had come out with that the previous year, we got such a great response that we decided to take on a new form that would be optional for buyers, and that's the cover sheet. And we hope that you all really like that form and put it to great use. So the residential sales contract. So the first thing that we had to do is we needed to address, sometimes when we're making changes or making revisions, we do so because essentially there is a business related purpose, there's a legal purpose, or a legislative related purpose. And the first change that I won't spend a lot of time on here is for you to know that essentially the opening paragraph was revised to remove the reference to cooperating brokerage representing seller and dual or designated agency. We removed that from that first paragraph. The second thing that we did that really impacted the rest of the contract was the access paragraph was removed and those requirements were redistributed to the contingencies that we have in our contract. And the reason why is we wanted to address a number of issues that were going on in the business where people would use essentially that general clause and expand the use. People were using final walkthroughs to conduct 3, 4, 5 hour home inspections, for example, and the access to property paragraph by means of things in the contract. We felt like we could address that better by addressing the access in each respective contingency. And that way, we also eliminated a provision where agents were writing in provisions. And that's a good way to dovetail into the last bullet point. We removed the other term section. And the reason is that if we're going to amend the main contract, if we're going to do that, we should do through the best business practice is to do that through an addendum to the contract. A lot of people were putting in information in that section that A, was potentially misleading, B, was unclear, or C, was just something that they wanted to put in, but it actually could have modified another general provision that was in the main body of the contract. So we felt like it was best to remove other terms and just to teach that the best thing to do is if you want a provision added, just do so through an addendum to the contract. Because as we all know, the addendum supersedes what's in the main body of the contract, all right? So then the first part that we modified, we reformatted for clarity's sake, consistency of definitions, and more easily accommodated cash offers. You know, we have learned over the last few renditions of improvements that we've made to our contract that essentially everyone loves the clarity of the first page. And so this gave us a great opportunity to essentially address a few different items that came up. By the way, just as all of you know, as a member of the forums committee, one of the great things that essentially we do is we take a lot of information and input from the hotline calls. So probably I see that we have 30 to 40 people on this particular Zoom presentation, but all know that every question that you ask and obviously is addressed and answered through the hotline is also something that goes directly to the forms committee. And we look at those things and those issues to see if, oh, wait, are we missing something in the contract? Is there a better way for us to address this issue? And so one of the things that came up and what we tackled was, how do we make paragraph 2 the very best that it can be? And also, how can we have it address, you know, situations where there's a difference between, you know, somebody that just has a strong belief that they're going to get their financing, so they may be able to have a contract or present an offer that's not contingent on financing, but they clearly intend to get it. And then also differentiating that from a cash offer, because a cash offer, if somebody obviously has the cash to pay, that's got even less risk, and they should be able to highlight the fact that they're going to actually pay cash. And so what we did here is we modified this provision, and you can see, I'm going to point you to the highlighted provision. So sales price obviously is clear. Down payment is right there and it's clear, but we put a note that says, if no financing, down payment equals sales price. So you could use the dollar figure and then A and B would be the exact same. Let's just say it's $1 million. So you have $1 million on A and the down payment would be $1 million or 100%. It's a very clear way to essentially address that issue. The rest of the box is pretty much the same as usual, except for one note. In D, I just wanted to address this one point. We continued on the hotline to have sellers question the idea of the definition of seller subsidy. And though we've defined it in our contract, we felt like this was a great place to also make it a little more clear. And so it says, seller subsidy to buyer. See, a lot of sellers were just like, a subsidy to me, that means it's coming to me, I'm getting the benefit. We as a forums committee didn't really understand why sellers were thinking that or why those issues were coming up on a hotline, but we felt like, all right, what's the best way for us to just nip this and make it clear? And so we put here seller subsidy to buyer, seller's net reduced by. So then it's clear that the seller knows that what's ever going in this line is going to be a credit to the buyer and a reduction ultimately from what they would receive at closing. You know, paragraph 2E, it removes the requirements for the seller to comply with reasonable lender requirements. We decided to move that. It was more appropriate to be in the title paragraph. which also we made some adjustments to, which I'll get to in just a second. And then you can see in E, we have the financing contingency that essentially it's very similar. The contract either is contingent with the addendum attached or is not contingent on financing. And then we have all of those provisions ultimately addressed right there. The next is paragraph 2F, the appraisal contingency. And so this is a new paragraph. And this is where we really took the opportunity to start to address this access to property paragraph directly in the contingency itself. So if you see here, I have a snippet of the new paragraph, but it addresses access to the since access paragraph was removed, essentially, we've addressed the issue of seller's obligation to provide access to an appraiser where the contract is contingent on financing and or appraisal. And if the contract is not contingent on financing or appraisal, the parties must negotiate access. So look at the paragraph. Clearly, if we have a contingency, it's going to say this contract is contingent, addendum attached, very similar to financing, which I just mentioned, or is not contingent on appraisal. If this contract is contingent on finance appraisal, seller will provide access for appraisals, reasonable access to the property for appraisal purposes. If this contract is not contingent on financing and or appraisal, seller checkbox will or seller will not provide appraiser reasonable access for appraisal purposes. So think about this for just a second. What many people were doing is they would write a contract that was not contingent on financing and would then not put an addendum in there. But then we had to deal with the issue of the seller providing access. Because remember, our access to property paragraph stated that the access was granted when the contract required the access. Well, if there's no financing contingency, if there's no appraisal contingency, then the contract doesn't require it. So what most agents were doing is they put a blurb, maybe in the additional provisions section, which would say, all parties acknowledge and agree that this contract is not contingent on financing, not contingent on appraisal, but the buyer reserves the right to pursue financing, and therefore the seller will grant access for appraisal purposes. Well, now we've eliminated that, which is obviously a good thing because agents taking it upon themselves to draft language could lead to essentially the unauthorized practice of law. And so now we've just done it right here. So if you're writing an offer where you know the contract is not contingent on financing and appraisal, you check those boxes just as you would have done before. And then you just say, though, because you know your client's going to need access, that you go down below and you say seller checkbox will provide appraisers reasonable access for appraisal purposes. And it's just that easy. You no longer have to essentially draft language. It's right here in the body of the contingency in order to gain access if it's not contingent. And then paragraph 2G, buyer's representations. We really thought that this was a more appropriate place for it. You know, the buyer representation paragraph being all the way in 15, it's something that could get lost. Obviously, everybody should read the contract from start to finish, but we thought that it would be better placed here because what is it that that paragraph actually has a lot of important information. One, it says that the buyer is going to represent whether or not they will or will not occupy the property as their principal residence, which goes through a lot of different things. One that comes to mind is based on the price. You know, if the buyer's occupying the property as their principal residence, you know, the foreign investment and real property taxes may not apply, okay, as a result. Also, it has in bold there, unless specified in a written contingency, neither this contract nor financing is dependent or contingent on the sale and settlement or lease of other real property. And that's really important because that representation needs to be made and the buyer needs to be made aware of the fact that if they have another property and their lender has said, oh, wait a second, your ratios are not going to work unless you lease out your condo, for example, or if you sell your home, as an example, then they need to know right here, oh, wait a second, I need to put another contingency in for that thing to happen. Otherwise, I'm going to be in default if I can't perform because I haven't leased out my property or I haven't sold it. And by the way, a lot of agents think that because the lender's letter might stipulate that in their lender's letter. That does not make it a contingency in the contract. That lender's letter is not it's not part of the contract. So it's important. This is a great place for the buyer right at the front end to recognize what contingencies they may need in order to satisfy the terms and conditions of the contract and not be in default. Okay. The next big thing, and what I might do here, Maria, are there any questions that I should address regarding that first part?
No, not yet.
Okay, great. Then I'm going to move on to the deposit. We got a lot of input from membership regarding a concern. And the concern was whether or not essentially when a buyer fails to provide the earnest money deposit. And there's other contracts that do address this specific issue. And so we thought about it as a committee, and we got a lot of input, again, as I said, from membership. And so we decided to address it. And this is something that everybody really needs to remember here. And it says, obviously, seller has now the option to declare the contract void if the buyer does not deliver the earnest money deposit by the deadline, with parties agreeing to assign a release pursuant to the void paragraph, all right? Buyer can certainly cure the default at any time for the seller before the seller delivers such notice. But it's really important that everybody recognize this fact. So this gives the buyer, let's just say that our earnest money deposit is due today. Buyer fails to do it. As soon as tomorrow comes, that seller can give notice voiding the contract to the buyer. And so some people think, oh, well, wait a second, there's not a cure period, there's not other things. The reason why we did this is that the buyer is in the best position to actually make the determination as to when they can deliver that earnest money deposit by, all right? And I think all of the buyer agents that are on, that are taking part in this presentation, you need to remember, when you're talking to your client, and maybe it's early on in the process, you need to talk about whether or not the money that they have that they're ready to use for the deposit, whether it's liquid. I think more often than not, what I have found as a title attorney, because a lot of settlement companies now are holding earnest money deposits. So what I find is when someone's late, the reason why they're late is not because they didn't care or they didn't want, their intention wasn't to deliver it on time. They didn't realize that maybe they were getting it from stocks and they had to make a trade or do something like that, liquidate it in order to deliver it. Or they were getting it from a gift from a parent or something like that. And there was just additional time that was necessary. So the lesson learned here is talk to your clients. Make sure that their money is in a position to deliver it. And when you're writing the offer, that they know that they can actually deliver the money right now and within that time frame. So I think education on the front end is going to cure this. What it also does is essentially when someone actually does not deliver it, it gives the seller the power just to void the contract. And especially when they're dealing with a buyer that may not be wanting to perform. And then it also moves that they have to execute a release agreement pursuant to the void paragraph in the contract. And finally, the blue section, so that changes in the yellow section. The blue section down below, what we did is we took the escrow agent liability paragraph, we removed it from default, and we put it here because it was just more appropriate to be in this section of the contract. Okay, paragraph 4, settlement. This really isn't, this is not a change, okay? But in Virginia, it's a custom for there to be split settlements where the seller will decide to sell with somebody or settle, go to closing with someone else, and maybe it's another title company. Or a seller may even say, you know what, I want someone to represent me, so I'm going to employ this law firm to actually represent, and I'm going to sign with them. Well, the seller has the right to choose whomever they're going to sign with, but because oftentimes they're going to choose an attorney that works with a settlement company, there was some confusion regarding who the settlement agent is. So we took this opportunity under the law, the buyer has the right to designate who the settlement agent's going to be. And what the seller needs to realize is they need to comply with essentially performance by meeting the terms and getting all the documents, even if they decide to sign elsewhere, performance to them is with this settlement agent. So if you look, we made a combination here of both paragraphs, and I love it because performance back in paragraph 27, it is just, let's just say it's overlooked. We all know, and I know everybody on this call loves reading the contract every day, right? Okay. Well, maybe it's just me that likes to do that. But performance is so critically important that we need this on the front end of the contract, not all the way back in paragraph 27. So we move that right here. And I just want to show you that in the blue section here, it says performance is done with the delivery of the required funds. Yes, we all know that, but also executed documents to the settlement agent will continue sufficient tender of performance. We now have people that are signing all over the place in order to do closings. Now with technology, many sellers, probably just thinking about my own company, we're up around 90% of our sellers are signing using remote online notarization. And so it's important for everybody to recognize the fact that in Virginia, especially, if the seller decides to sign someone else somewhere else, that's fine, but they can't do it at a time where they can't deliver the documents to the settlement agent that's identified in this paragraph. Otherwise, they would be in default. That's why we essentially addressed it here. Paragraph 6, delivery, we edited just to streamline and we removed a bunch of unnecessary clauses. Less is more. And by the way, our ability to do this throughout the contract reduced the pages of the contract by a page. We got down to now 12 pages, which I know makes everybody happy when we're actually able to concisely, you know, get our contract to a smaller provision. But delivery, this is one of the ways that we did it, and we've done it elsewhere as well, which I'll get to in just a minute. And then paragraph 7, we provided a link to the statute regarding the residential property disclosure acknowledgement. The reason for this, and we removed a lot of the other languages, remember, the buyer must sign the residential property disclosure acknowledgement, and the additional language was repetitive. You might recall that we did this when we were dealing with HOA and condo. We had a lot of language that was not necessary to be there. So what we've done is we've cited the statute. We know that a listing agent, a good listing agent, is going to have the seller acknowledge the DPOR document, obviously, upfront, and that will be made a part of any buyer being making an offer. So the buyer can just acknowledge that as part of their offer. And that's why we're able to, again, reduce pages to the contract because we just adjusted that here. Paragraph 10, property maintenance and condition. This is another place where we combined the former paragraph 11 regarding access, okay? So we stated that obviously if we have a contingency, a home inspection contingency, then obviously the seller is going to give reasonable access to the property because it's contingent. Well, that makes sense. The seller is going to have to do that. It's a requirement in the contract. The second part, though, it clarifies who may attend the final walkthrough. So I want to point your attention to two different parts here. One is the yellow, and then the second is the blue. The yellow, what it does is it obviously checks off when if this contract is contingent, then obviously the seller is going to give access for the inspector to do the home inspection with the buyer and obviously their agent. We also provided a provision here where in essence, the buyer can get access even though the contract is not contingent on a home inspection. So if you look at the, however, if checked, seller will provide broker, buyer, and licensed professional insured inspectors, blah, 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 access to the property beginning on blank and ending on blank. So you could have a situation, the reason why this provision was put in here, you get the buyer, though this contract is not contingent on a home inspection, maybe the buyer did a pre-inspection or something like that. But essentially They could get access to do a home inspection for informational purposes only. They could get access for a contractor to come in and do estimates. And the parties can state right here the period of time that the buyer has the right to do those inspections, though, essentially, or get access to the property, though this contract is not contingent. As an attorney, you know, my thoughts go there that I don't really like if you don't have a contingency in the contract, I don't really understand why you're gaining access for informational purposes only. Do it after the settlement. But our membership has come to do this. And though, even though I might not see that it's contractually necessary to do this, there has been a real, this has been something that membership has done. And so we have kept and given a vehicle for that continue to happen. And there's also, I think we did a great job here of also giving access for other things like, you know, you want to do measurements or you'd want to do something else. All of that is here and it freely allows the parties to negotiate that right here within the contract. And then last but not least, you know, I had mentioned at the outset that we address the fact that the access to property paragraph was being broadened and buyer representative was being used to mean lots of different things. And so we nip that here, okay, by putting right here in the language, regardless of whether this contract is contingent upon the home inspection or inspections and or other inspections, seller will provide broker and buyer reasonable access to property to make walkthrough inspections within 7 days prior to the settlement and or occupancy. So what we've addressed here, everybody, is the fact that now there's no longer this open-ended buyer representative. It's broker and buyer. Now, we have addressed the idea of the buyer through a home inspection contingency and a negotiation to allow that inspector to come back. And I'll talk about that in just a few minutes. All right, paragraph 11, possession date. Again, we moved this up. It was back in paragraph 22. And so we thought that it would be better to move this forward regarding possession. We also, and this was really, the makeup of our committee is made up of settlement attorneys, made up of realtors, licensed professionals, and real estate brokers. And the settlement attorneys is a smaller percentage, obviously, of all of you that are doing business. I say that as a backdrop because I want you to know mailbox keys came from the settlement attorney side of things. I can't tell you how many times I've sat at the table and I have somebody say, where are the mailbox keys? We're like, oh, and you call the seller and they don't have them or they don't know where it is. And, you know, it's just this thing. It wasn't addressed in our contract. So we decided to address it here. And we still have the provision, if any. So mailbox keys, if any, just like obviously you could have other keys or fobs or things like that, if any. Possession date, it's important that ultimately, and you can see paragraph 11, we addressed it here. And we also chose to now address the seller will transfer exclusive control of any smart devices to buyer at settlement. Okay. Lots of properties, including my own, we all have different things, right? We have the ability to gain access to the house, maybe with an alarm system. We have, there's video and things like that that's used. There's recording information that we have in our houses and things like that. Also, we have thermostats where we can adjust, we can turn lights on and off and things like that in our house. So finally, we've essentially addressed that here. And so smart devices now is defined in our personal property and fixtures paragraph. We have all of that outlined. And ultimately we address that in possession as well. And then we streamlined, and I thought this was great. We streamlined the check boxes. We just decided to remove no, because why would you have no? Either it applies, yes, or you just don't check it. You don't need two sets of boxes. And this change you'll see has actually been changed in multiple places within our other documents, as I had mentioned before. And last, which I think really is cool, is we added other conveyances and does not convey. We decided to take on this idea. Many of you write contracts and the buyer and the seller negotiate for personal property. Well, obviously, we're in the business of selling real property, not personal property. And so we decided to try to address this where we could impact where a seller is just allowing something to stay in the property that everybody acknowledges that there's no value given. And I thought it was really smart. We actually reached out to six of our affiliated lenders within NVAR, and we asked them to ask their toughest underwriters to come up with language that we could use so we didn't have to do a separate bill of sale. We could actually just address it right here in the contract. And you'll see there in the highlighted portion at the bottom, it says other conveyances, and then it says as is, no additional value, and for seller's convenience. That language is what says to a lender, I don't need to worry about this from an appraisal purpose. And the thing that I always remember is, you know, that pool table, obviously down in the basement where the buyers are like, great, I'd love to have the pool table. And the seller's just like, thank goodness, because I don't want to move it. That type of item is perfect right here. And then we, for clarity's sake, we also added does not convey. So a seller can simply put in, let's say they have a chandelier that they absolutely love. Maybe it has some family history to it and they want to take that with them. Well, now they can just take it. They don't have to replace it. There's not any, oh, well, what am I going to get? Is there a like kind? The buyer's now put on notice. This won't convey. Seller's taking it. And the buyer knows they're going to need to replace that item. Okay. Wood destroying insect inspection, we modified this paragraph essentially to clarify that the seller must perform any treatment or repairs per the recommendation of the inspector. So they're obligated to do it. And then the seller must provide access to buyer, broker, and WDI inspector to perform the inspection. So there was, we talked about this quite at length with the group that there was this, it was the idea that really a buyer just essentially, let's say that the buyer at their expense has the inspection that's done, and then the seller has to do the work. But there's also this idea that the buyer should have access, the inspector should have access, and their agent to make sure essentially that all the work was done properly and things like that. So we modified this paragraph so that the seller acknowledges that access is here. It's really in the same vein as what we did with the rest of the contract, where removing the access to property paragraph, ultimately, we needed to make sure that we addressed access here as well. And then paragraph 20, which it's the title paragraph. And as a title attorney, I'm going to say most important paragraph in the contract. I digress. Okay. Obviously, it's not. But you can see we actually modified and changed the terms pretty significantly. We removed a lot of unnecessary language regarding the fact that if the seller is unable to deliver marketable insurable title by the settlement date, they're in default. I mean, it's clear that that is the case. So we just removed a lot of that unnecessary language. And we also allow that the parties can obviously agree to extend the settlement to allow the seller more time to clear title. In our contract, one of the things that I love about it is we often refer to the fact that the parties can always mutually agree to do something. And so we call on that. And obviously, if there is that mutual agreement, as I stated before, you're going to do that through an addendum to the contract because you're superseding by using that addendum what's already in the contract of sale. The other things that we wanted to address here, and I believe personally that this is long overdue, is we had an opportunity here. Our contract was open. It said it used the language that would have allowed the seller, after the contract was ratified, to enter into an easement agreement or a covenant that affected the property. Because as long as that was in place by the settlement date, the buyer was obligated to perform. So we addressed that. Now the seller is now prohibited from unilaterally recording an easement, covenant, or other restriction on title between the contract ratification and settlement. It must be in place as of the date of ratification. And that was an important distinction. I know most people are like, well, why would they do that? The fact is that they could do that. And that was not it wasn't an equitable situation for the seller to be able to do that after the buyer and the seller have come to terms and had a ratified contract. So we address that here. Paragraph 26. The default paragraph, there is a bunch of language that actually addressed the broker, okay, the real estate broker, accepting half of the deposit in lieu of commission when somebody's in default. And we just felt like that was more appropriately addressed in the buyer agency agreement or in the listing agreement. And so we removed that language here. It also gave us an opportunity to shorten the contract. And then, because essentially the brokers aren't executing the contract anyway, they're executing those agreements that I had mentioned before. We modified the paragraph, the void contract paragraph, to deal with, if any, regarding the deposit. So if the buyer fails to deliver, the seller sends notice to the buyer voiding the contract because the buyer failed to deliver the deposit. Now we have if any, because if there's no deposit, they can just sign the release agreement. And then paragraph 30, we just essentially decided under times of the essence, which everybody knows, times of the essence is a really important provision in our contract because it locks in the dates. We had a provision regarding TRID. Remember when obviously back in 2015, we went to, rather than the HUD-1 settlement statement with a good faith estimate, now we have essentially the closing disclosure rule and the three-day rule that needs to be delivered. Because that's been in place and we have not seen settlements delayed, we now remove that provision. I think it's timely. We do not see settlement dates moving due to TRID. So we remove that provision. And then ultimately, the entire agreement, paragraph 32, it incorporated the miscellaneous paragraph 32 clauses into one well-defined coherent section. And that actually wraps up the main contract. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to move on to the inspection addendum. Okay. So the first thing that we did, and in the, in the spirit of less is more, let's stay with that, that essentially what we did was we removed our home inspection and radon testing contingency addendum restated things multiple times. And now what we've done is, rather than saying things one, two, three times, we now just have one miscellaneous provision that applies to all of those sections. It's a great way to essentially reduce paper, okay, and reduce the amount. It also is a way to make a contract more user-friendly and more concise. So essentially, that's what we've done. And then I love this addition that we've made. Clearly states that the home inspection for purposes of the contingency includes all types of inspections except those of which NVAR already has a separate clause or addendum. So our home inspection paragraph has always had that the buyer has the ability to do inspections, plural, right? And so that would allow a buyer to have a home inspector come through, do a home inspection. Obviously, if the buyer also during that same time frame wanted another inspection done, let's say they want to inspect the chimney of the house and they need somebody who's specific to chimney, they can obviously have that inspection or that license firm come out and address that issue. But it was unfair in that essentially it was broad as to all inspections. What we needed to address was other inspections that are negotiable in our contract should be eliminated and removed from the buyer to be able to do those inspections under this contingency. So in yellow, you'll see there, for the purpose of this home inspection contingency, inspection does not include radon testing, well inspection, or septic inspection, unless otherwise agreed by separate clause or addendum. It just wasn't fair for the buyer to get access to do these inspections when they had the opportunity to negotiate for those inspections with the seller. So now they cannot essentially do that as part of this inspection. They need to have another inspection contingency. And then the inspection contingency removal addendum, you might recall that essentially now through the final walkthrough, only the final walkthrough gives access to the buyer and the broker, right? Not a buyer representative. But in certain circumstances, and we heard this when we addressed this with the board, in certain circumstances, there's a requirement where the agent and the buyer don't feel comfortable enough making a decision as to whether or not the work that was done by the seller is adequate, or it was done by their licensed contractor is adequate. So they wanted to have the right to bring back the home inspector. Well, perfect opportunity to do that. And when your contract is contingent on an inspection, and as a release of the home inspection contingency, the seller has agreed to have the following enumerated items addressed, this was a perfect opportunity for the seller to grant access during the final walkthrough for a home inspector. So you'll see in yellow there, it says, if seller agrees to make any repairs in this addendum, seller will provide broker, buyer, and licensed, if applicable, professional, insured inspectors, retained by buyer, reasonable access to property to make final walkthrough inspections within 7 days prior to settlement and or occupancy. So now, though we've addressed that it's only buyer and broker, especially when the contract's not contingent on a home inspection contingency, if the seller agrees to make repairs, now the seller is giving access for the buyer to bring back that home inspector if they want, or the licensed professional they're choosing, to make sure that the repair that the seller had made is actually done adequately. And my suggestion to all of you, I think the best practice, we have a very broad, 7 days for the buyer to come back and do inspections. My suggestion would be for the buyer to essentially have those items that the seller, is going to actually address those repairs, that you bring in the home inspector for those things and you do that. And then maybe closer to settlement, you do your normal final walkthrough to make sure that the seller delivered the property vacant, free and clear of trash and debris and everything else that's required. Okay, listings. A lot of these changes, everyone, is going to go directly to what I said before. Because we made changes elsewhere, we needed to modify these forms. So the two listing agreements, exclusive right to sell and exclusive agency listing agreement, we modified so that it's consistent with formatting for personal property and fixtures, okay? We removed no checkboxes, just as we've done, and we put in there the other conveyances and does not convey. And we also added all the provisions regarding smart home devices. And then the optional listing information sheet, we added a provision here, remember that the optional listing information sheet is not a required form, but we have found that a lot of membership have loved using it. And we received input from the hotline that a good addition might be for the seller to have the option to request from the buyer the following items. And so you'll see in yellow, seller requests, checkbox, proof of funds with cash offers, and checkbox, lender letter, check all that apply. So obviously the seller could put that both in there. So if a buyer's writing a cash offer, the buyer to put their best foot forward, now they're put on notice, hey, the seller's gonna wanna see my bank statement showing that I have the cash essentially available to buy in cash, and I can show proof of that. They don't have to, it's not a requirement that they do it, but the seller is saying, hey buyer, put your best foot forward. They're also doing that regarding a lender letter. Put your best foot forward, buyer. If you think that you're solid and you're going to be able to meet this contract and go to settlement, provide a lender's letter that demonstrates to me you've done all the things in order to do that. So again, not a required form, but something that really helps a buyer put their best foot forward. And then finally, the new form, we put together an optional buyer offer cover sheet. And we did this and we worked really hard to get to one page. And so we hope that we've done a good job here. Let me tell you a little bit of the background. We know many buyer agents will put together to basically put their buyers in the best light. They'll provide a summary sheet for a listing agent to walk through and take their client through what would be the offer. This is in the same vein. What we wanted to do is essentially provide to our membership a form where a buyer can clearly state exactly what the terms are. So you're going to see something that you can see at the very top of this. It's reflective of the first page of the contract, which has all the clear information, most of the things that the seller is going to want to know and see. We also then, right after that, what's most important? What contingencies are in the contract? Or do I have a really strong buyer where they're waiving? They're not doing these contingencies. Awesome to have that right here. Other information, some of the things that are like Is the buyer occupying the property? How quickly can the buyer close? All of those things are in the other information. And then finally, we have the cooperating broker information in there where you're going to put that information. And that's going to be signed by the listing agent or an acknowledgement. You know, I think what this does is it allows for a couple of different things. One, allows the buyer to put their best foot forward. It's important to note, because this is an optional form, this is not a part of the contract. So all listing agents need to know, first let me start with the buyer agents. The buyer agent should make sure that this sheet is consistent with what's in the contract. But all listing agents need to know that this is not the contract. You need to make sure that whatever this summary sheet is, that what's in the contract actually is the same as that. And finally, you know, we heard from membership, there was a lot of, because buyers have been writing on multiple properties, we also heard that there was just a want to make sure that the offer was actually, you know, properly submitted to the seller, that it was reviewed as well. So this is a great place, you'll see in the second bullet there, provides a way for the cooperating agent to request that the listing agent confirm in writing that buyer's offer has been presented and that the seller has waived the presentment in accordance with the code of ethics. So we just wanted to address that issue here. It's come up and we thought this was the best way to do it. Now that we're introducing this form, we hope all of you use it and we would love to get your feedback of how it works in the marketplace. And so what I'll do is, I know we ended about with about 13 minutes left. So I just want to open it up to any questions that people may have.
Marty, I see a question from Anna Marie Termini, which says, what does check all that apply mean? It looks like it's referring to two mutually exclusive items. I think they're talking about the optional cover sheet where it says buyer includes proof of funds with cash offer or and lender letter.
Oh, going back to the optional listing information sheet?
Yes. Or the buyer offer cover sheet.
Oh, sure. Because obviously this form shall not, okay. What we're talking here is you're checking all that apply because some of these are not. So if you're like, for example, your contingencies, you're going to put in there, you know, if you have a finance contingency, yes. Or obviously, if there's not going to be one, that's no, you're going to check all that apply. If they don't apply, then don't check the box. I don't know, Maria, if I'm answering the question properly.
She says, no, the form before, where the proof of cash or a lender letter has a check mark. Yeah.
Check all that apply, because I think that's a good question, because you know, you're asking essentially, why not just check both? Because if you're going to get a cash offer, you're going to want to see proof of funds. If you don't want to eliminate one versus the other. I think the reason why we put that language in there is because we just thought that it was appropriate because it's an optional form. But in most cases, I think what most agents would do is they probably would just check both, because if there's a cash offer, the seller is going to want to see that the buyer has proof of funds. And then if it's going to be a lender's letter that they're looking for, if it's financing, your seller is going to want to see that they've actually been pre-approved for financing. So I think you, in practice, you probably would just check both.
Mm-hmm. Someone is anonymous, wants to know, if the home inspection is information only, do you check the box that says you're waiving all inspection?
No, you wouldn't check the box that you're waiving all inspections. If I go back, just give me a second. I'm going to go back to that provision. Oh, I think I, there it is. So if you're the two check boxes that are up above is where you're saying this contract is contingent upon a home inspection and you're attaching the addendum, or the buyer waives the opportunity to make the contract contingent on and or other inspections of the property. So if your client's waiving the inspection, you check the second box. If they're not, you're going to attach the addendum and you're going to check the first box. The access, the question is, how do you gain access when you don't have a contingency? You do that by checking the box where it says, however, if checked, seller will provide broker access to the property, and then you fill in the dates. Does that make sense?
Yep. Does to me.
Okay, good.
That's all we have here on the Q&A.
Does anybody have the opportunity to unmute to answer a question or ask a question?
I see something now on the chat, sorry, that Deborah asks, number 16, other provisions was an easy way to insert an offer deadline. Now we need to create an addendum for a simple item and the like.
And who was that? Who asked that
this
question?
This is Deborah Davis.
All right, Deborah, we discussed that ad nauseum, okay, regarding that, because a lot of people used that other provision section for many different reasons. Mm-hmm. And I totally get it. In certain circumstances, you're just like, I can make this really clear. This offer is only valid for until such and such a date and time, right? But that's not the only reason as to what it was used for. And so the most appropriate thing to do is, rather than give agents an opportunity to write in material terms of the contract, the best business practice is to just do an addendum to the contract that clearly states what's being done. Obviously, if you want to limit the offer, you do that through the general addendum. It's the same thing. Prior to the seller ultimately accepting that offer during that time, you know, it's only good through this period. The fact that it's moved to an addendum in your case doesn't matter. I know there's an ease. Why do I have to create this addendum? I think what you're going to find is that as we continue to make improvements, remember I had mentioned we're building the foundation, and the foundation that we're building with best practices in mind is let's have a solid contract. Let's remove a provision where people write in a lot of different things that really isn't the best business practice. Let's get them to be using general addendums to the contract for those terms. That's the right business practice. And I know going forward, as we modify things in the future regarding contingencies and things like that, which you'll see, I know that we know as a committee that this was the best thing to do, is to remove that provision and just teach people best thing to do is use a general addendum to the contract.
That's all I see.
I think we just got one more, and somebody raised their hand too.
Lynn Cooper wants to know, yeah, she wants you to confirm that the addenda supersede the contract.
Yes,
you can Lynn. Explain that.
Lynn, you're 100% correct. Any addenda to the contract supersedes what's in the main body of the contract. All right. Oh, I see our chats are going up, Maria.
Yes, there are no actual questions. It's more discussion. So I don't see anything specific to address here. Of course, if you guys ever have any specific questions that you want to ask, please just go ahead and submit the question on the legal hotline on NVAR.com. We can talk a little bit more specifics if you guys have any more specific questions.
The last question, and maybe we'll just take this as the last one. Anna Marie asked, does the addendum require a reference to a paragraph in the main contract? Technically, it does not. Okay. I think often the best thing to do, if you're going to address a specific provision in the contract, I often do say refer to it because I think it adds clarity. But it's not necessary. An addendum to the contract is an addendum to the contract. And whatever that provision is that the parties agree to, it's going to supersede what's in the main body of the contract. So it's not necessary to do that. But I think as an attorney, if it adds clarity, oftentimes what I'll do is I'll say, you know, if there's a provision in a contract that we want to amend, I might even write on that page, see general addendum or see addendum to contract. And then they know that that's the provision that ultimately is going to be a change. There's a follow-up to that, or maybe it's in this situation, the sellers allow home inspection for information purposes only after all other contingencies are satisfied. It is very hard to define the dates in this section. I appreciate that. Every situation is going to be a little bit different. And remember what we're doing when we make this change, we're addressing this and we're putting it out for all of you to use. I think what's important is, and I think the changes with the contract that we've made, it makes people really think about these things. It allows the parties to freely mutually negotiate a great outcome. And so that's it. In certain situations, you're going to have things that are going to be unique. And those sets of circumstances are really addressed by great agents dealing with things. If what we have put in the main contract needs to be addressed, just do that through an addendum to the contract, and that will supersede, okay? And also adding clarity, what you said, I'm not allowed to bring other inspectors like fireplace and chimney in the home inspection period without additional approval from seller. Actually, that's not the case. Our inspections paragraph is plural under the home inspection. So I'm assuming that you have a home inspection contingency. And under that, it says inspections. So as long as the time is allotted, let's say it's 5 days to do the home inspection, the buyer has access to do those inspections. And that could include a chimney inspection. That could include an inspection of a pool if they wanted to, if the inspection company was not licensed or was not in a position to actually inspect that item for the buyer. They have, during that period, they have the ability to have all of those inspections. What they no longer have the ability to do, because we address this, is if it's a septic inspection or something else, those inspections are only allowed if there's a separate written contingency. Okay? Yeah, you got it. I see now you understand and that we're all set. And so with that, that takes us right to 1057. I just want to thank all of you for the opportunity to present to you today. It was a pleasure being chair of Standard Forms. I'm still a member of the Forms Committee this year. We're gonna use this foundation to do great things with our contract that's always in your best interest, our membership, and obviously buyers and sellers, your clients that we work with. And also, I just wanna say that it's wonderful to be able to work with people like Renee, Maria, Matt. All of the people at NVAR are really wonderful. And all of the members of our committee for Standard Forms, my co-chair, Diane, who's now the chair this year, just wonderful, hardworking group of people that are here to serve your best interests. So I just want to thank everyone. It was a great 2021, and we're really looking forward to a great 2022 together. Thanks again. Renee, anything that I need?